power and gracious Father, be pleased to bless thy word now, save the lost, restore the backslidden, revive the church, and Father, glorify thy great name, we ask it, giving thanks in the Saviour's precious name. Amen. Now you should remember in our studies of the minor prophets that under the ministry of Jonah, the city of Nineveh, the capital city of the Assyrian Empire in the world in its day, was graciously spared the judgment of God through the preaching of Jonah. They repented of their sin. They came to the Lord. They were shown mercy. And I think it was one of the greatest revivals in the entire history, not only of the Bible, but the entire world. There hasn't been a revival like what happened in Nineveh when God spared that enemy of Israel and that persecutor of the people of God, that wicked nation that was in rebellion, that cruel and evil and depraved nation. And God spared all in that city, from the king on the throne to the maid at the mill. I'm convinced that one is one of the greatest acts of the loving kindness of Almighty God that's ever been recorded in the history of this world. However, 100 years later, when we come to the ministry of Nahum, the same city, the city of Nineveh, that Jonah preached to, that God spared, that the Lord had been good to, it's now under scrutiny from that same God. The same God who 100 years previous under the ministry of Jonah preached, yet 40 days Nineveh shall be destroyed. And they repented in sackcloth and ashes. And the king himself tore off his royal garments, put on sackcloth. It's basically like a camel hair garment. It's like putting on an old sack that irritates the skin so that there's humility. It's a sign of penitence and true and genuine repentance. And the king set the example to the very maid at the mill and to the obscure and even to the little children that couldn't discern their right hand from the left or even know good or evil. All were taught during that time of ministry 100 years previous that God was merciful, God was good, God was great, God was kind and compassionate, and God would punish sin, and if they repent, he'll pardon sin. And if they don't, he will judge the sin in the nation. And they repented. But when we fast forward 100 years, we come to the ministry of Nahum. And if you want to link minor prophets together, as I said, and this is a good practice, here's what you do. You take Jonah and you take Nahum and you link them together in a common ministry to the city of Nineveh. That's where their ministry was. They didn't preach to Israel. They didn't preach to Judah. All those other prophets were raised up like Joel, like Micah, like Hosea, and so on. But Jonah and Nahum, both of them had a distinct ministry, and it centered on one national people, the city of Nineveh. And there were hundreds of thousands of individuals. There was at least 120,000 children. They reckon that the population of Nineveh, when it was spared, and 100 years later, no doubt, it had grown. And a very populous city, one of the most beautiful cities in the known world. In fact, it literally could have been in that group of the seven wonders of the old and ancient world was the city of Nineveh and all the beauty of that city. And God spared that city. But 100 years later, he's delivering the same message, a message of judgment upon that city. The only difference this time between the ministry of Jonah and the ministry of Nahum is that the message is no longer tempered with mercy. God's patience has run out. You could write over the city of Nineveh 100 years after the preaching of Jonah, Genesis 6 and verse 3, "My spirit shall not always strive with man. My spirit, being quenched, resisted and grieved continually." My patience over 100 years of tolerating your rebellion. And what happened was this: the judgment that Nahum preached was not followed by kindness or mercy. It was final. It was irreversible. And as a result of that, that's exactly what you find in the book of Nahum. Notice in verse 2, the judgment is final. It is irreversible. God is jealous. The Lord revengeth. The Lord revengeth and is furious. The Lord will take vengeance. Notice it, will take vengeance. No mercy on his adversaries, and he reserveth wrath for his enemies. And notice as well in verse 8, it says, but with an overrunning flood, he will make an utter end of the place thereof, and darkness shall pursue his enemies. Verse 9, what do you imagine against the Lord? He will make an utter end. Affliction shall not rise up the second time. In other words, there's no second chance now. It's over. And what happened to Nineveh? What happened to that great city that was favored of God and blessed of the Lord? What happened to that great city? I'll tell you exactly what happened to it. Nineveh repented of their repentance. In other words, they treated the mercy of God as nothing, as meaningless. They forgot what God had done. They didn't remember that God was jealous, that God would punish sin. They thought they could fly in the face and defiance of Almighty God. They thought they could just break his laws with impunity, no punishment. They thought it didn't matter. They repented of their repentance. They turned back to their old ways. And for 100 years, that's right, 100 years. And there's a connection with 100 years. I want you to connect 100 years with the minor prophets. Now, how do we do that? Very simply. I want you to connect that number, 100 years, with the minor prophets. You can connect it with Nahum. 100 years after Jonah, Nahum ministered and preached judgment. And you can connect it. You can connect it with the book of Haggai. And you can connect it with the book of Zechariah and Malachi. Because Malachi, 100 years after the first return under Zerubbabel and the ministry of Haggai and Zechariah, 100 years later, Malachi came and he preached to God's people this time because they had repented of their repentance. They had turned back to their old ways. That's why God raised up Malachi. And so there is a connection between Nahum and Malachi, and they have something in common, and it's this. 100 years later, after great blessing, Malachi and Nahum were raised up. Now, they were not contemporaries, by the way. Malachi was the last of the prophets. And for 400 years, God never sent a prophet to Israel. Not one. He gave a promise of one. In fact, he gave a promise of two. First one was John the Baptist. You'll find it in the book of Malachi. And the second one was in the book of Deuteronomy, when he says, a prophet like unto thee, Moses, will I raise up. And Israel always looked. Do you remember when the Lord said to the Pharisees, who do you think I am? Remember he said to his disciples, who do you think I am? Some said Jeremiah. Some said Elijah, because they knew Elijah would come. And John the Baptist was, I believe, Elijah coming. He came in the spirit of Elijah. But then they said, that prophet that God promised he would raise up. And John actually said these words. Who art thou? When the Pharisees were sent and the people were sent to ask John, who are you? What are you doing? What do you say of yourself? John said these words. I am not that prophet. But he was a prophet. But he wasn't that true prophet who would be the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And so I say to you, Malachi being the last, Nahum and Malachi have a connection, 100 years. Remember that in the minor prophets. Link them together in your study. They carried a similar message to different people, to a people who repented of their repentance and had literally spurned the mercy of God and treated the goodness and kindness and love and grace of God as something that was void, meaningless, nothing. And Nineveh, simply put, turned back. They literally repented of their repentance. They despised God's mercy. They rejected his law. They turned back to their wicked ways, and now the Lord would act without mercy. God would take this entire nation and they would suffer irreversible judgment. And today I want to examine the message of Nahum because it's right up to date. I want you to think of Nahum, a word for us all. First of all, there's a message for our land, our nation. There's a message for Great Britain. There's a message for the United Kingdom. There's a message for this province. There's a message for this nation to which we belong. There's a message for our land in the book of Nahum. There are principles. There are teachings here. There's counsel. There's instruction. I believe there's good, sound theology that's applicable in its principle to this very land in which we live, to this nation, although we are a Gentile nation. I want you to see that in a moment or two. Jonah, as you know, had brought Nineveh a message about the love and mercy of God if they repent. But through Nahum, God sent a message concerning his justice and his righteousness. Now both go together. The Lord is merciful. The Lord is slow to anger. The Lord is plenteous in mercy. And that's exactly what Nahum said. If you notice there in the verse 3 of chapter 1. The Lord is slow to anger and great in power and will not at all acquit the wicked. Now notice the words in verse 3. The Lord is great. The Lord is great. The Muslim, whenever they're under pressure, whenever they feel their religion is under attack, whenever they feel that you are opposing them, they begin to shout, Allah is great. That's what they shout. And maybe even when they're going to throw in a bomb, that's what they shout. They throw a bomb in and they're killing people and they say, Allah is great. Their God is great when he kills people with bombs. Think of it. Think of it. How evil is that religion? Now, no doubt, the Nolan Show will be picking up on this, but I don't care. How evil is a religion that says their God is great when you throw a bomb into a crowd of innocent people and you say they're nothing but heathen dogs unless they're one of us? Well, that's what those extreme terrorists do. But I want to tell you something. There's no one great but the Lord. And the Bible says the Lord is great. Now, if that's all we have of our God, I want to tell you something. That's not great theology. I'll tell you why. Because if God was great and he wasn't merciful, if God was great and he wasn't good, he would be a monster. He would be a despot. There are people in this world and they have power and they're great, but they're not good. There are dictators in this world and they have extreme and they have absolute power and they supremely rule over their citizens and they're great in that sense, but they're not good. And they're evil people and they treat their people in a wicked way. But the Lord, Nahum said to Nineveh, the Lord is great. He can do anything. But he added this in verse 7, the Lord is good. And that, I tell you, is good theology. And that's the God we have. He's great. He can do anything, but he's good. He's good. And greatness and goodness mark God out different from any other false gods in this world. And therefore, when he was preaching the message to Nineveh, he was reminding them, God is great, greater than Assyria, but God is good. You remember 100 years ago how good God was to you. Now God is great. He can do anything, but he's good. But his goodness has been betrayed. His mercy has been spurred. And now there is little or no hope for you. That's exactly what we're hearing here. The Lord is slow to anger. 100 years. And think of the years previous. You could be talking 2 centuries. Patient, dealing with Nineveh and the rise of the Assyrian armies and empire. He was gracious and he was merciful to the Assyrian capital. These were heathen dogs. That's why Jonah didn't want them saved, because they were hateful, cruel, wicked people who had done the people of God to death, and they were a constant threat to Israel in the northern kingdom and Judah in the southern kingdom, and Assyria was the dominant power. Eventually they took Israel into captivity, the northern kingdom. It was the Assyrians that did it. And they butchered man, woman, and child. And Jonah knew how wicked and cruel they were. And he couldn't get over that God was going to spare them. You see, he knew his God. He knew God was great. Jonah knew God was good. In fact, he says in chapter 4, is it not, of Jonah's book, in the last chapter, did he not say, I knew that you would do this. I know who you are, and you're merciful, and you're gracious, and I feared you would do this to these people, and you would spare them, and I would rather see them damned than delivered. I want to tell you something. Both go together. The mercy and the justice, the goodness and the righteousness, both go together. You see, God warns sinners. God exhorts sinners to turn from their sin, to repent of their sin, and he counsels nations to abandon their foolish ways and their wicked ways and to seek his way. He's a God of inflexible justice. Look at verse 3. Even though he's slow to anger, even though he's plenteous in mercy, look at verse 3. He will not at all acquit the wicked. He'll not let the wicked go unpunished. He'll not justify the wicked. He'll not let their sin just go without punishment. They'll not sin with impunity. In other words, sinners are not free to continually practice their ungodliness. Don't you, as a child of God, be angry or envious at the wicked and those that prosper in their sin. We're angry at their sin. And we know what people are doing in this province to our young people. And I want to tell you this, in Newton Ards and Cumber, and we should awake to this, paramilitaries rule in those towns. I've come from Lisburn, where paramilitaries, where I lived, ruled. The government gave them money. They become community workers. They're parasites, and they live off the community. And we're told today by well-meaning Christians, don't you say that. You'll get yourself into trouble. You'll get the church into trouble. So we turn a blind eye to what's going on around us. There are young people today in your town in Cumber and in Newton Ards and in this district. And I want to tell you, their lives are ruined by paramilitaries. And they're on their backs. They call it child abuse when you abuse a child. I want to tell you something. Paramilitaries in this province are guilty of child abuse. That's a fact. That is a fact. It's time we stood up against them. And don't fear them. They're wicked, evil people. Pray God will save them. And if not, he would stop them in their tracks. And they're exploiting the young. And those young people, they're lending them money. The young people can't pay them back. And as a result of that, I'll tell you what they do. They can't pay them back. Their families don't have any money. They've gone and gotten a loan. And they're trying to pay back the paramilitaries. And the paramilitaries are charging them extortionate rates. Borrow $1,000 and you'll pay $2,500 back. And you've only 2 weeks to pay it. Where do you get the money? And if you don't have it, then there's two options. A severe beating. Or take these drugs and sell them on the street to get the money for us. And that's what's happening. It's a wicked, wicked place in the towns of our province. And many Christians are turning a blind eye. They shut their doors at 9 o'clock at night, tuck themselves up in their beds, go out to work and make their money, and the rest of the province can go to hell. That's a fact. It's time we woke up. And we saw what was going on in this country. Because God is about to judge this land. And that judgment will be irreversible. And hell is a real place. And if God begins to judge in this land and doesn't show mercy, this country's finished. And these things, we need to be shocked into these things. And we need to pray God will use us to reach the lost, to bring souls to Christ. I'm glad I can take you to hundreds of ex-paramilitaries that God has saved from both sides. God has saved them, changed them. They've left their violent ways and their wicked past, repented, and they've come to Christ. And he's forgiven them, and he's shown them mercy. I want to tell you, we have a younger generation that are facing terrible, terrible times. I want to tell you, God will not at all acquit the wicked and not let them go on in their ungodly ways. I want to tell you this, that well over 100 years, God has been spurring Nineveh. That terrible and terrible and awful judgment, he's been holding it back. God's about to work. I was praying over a verse of scripture this morning. It comes up in my daily readings in McShane. I might have read on, so if you're trying to find it today, it might not just be in today's readings, but I was reading on. But I came to that verse of Scripture in Psalm 119 and the verse 126, where it says, "It is time for thee to work, for they have made void thy law." And I brought my argument to God. I brought my argument to the Lord today. I lifted up my Bible to the Lord, literally. And I had the Bible open at that verse, and I says, "Lord, you've written it into the book. Here it is. I present my argument to you now. It is time for you to work. They have made void thy law. It's time. Lord, it's time. Now's the time. You've got to work, Lord. You've said it. In the day when they make void your law, it's time. It's now time, and it's time we lifted the Bible to God. And we presented our arguments in prayer to God and said, Lord, it's time for thee to work." Now, I don't know what work that will be. I don't know whether that will be a work of mercy. I pray it will. Or will that be a work of judgment when God will take people out and God will remove people? I don't know. I can't tell you exactly what the psalmist had in mind. I would suggest if the author of Psalm 119, and I believe it was, if it was Daniel, and he wrote the psalm in Babylon during the 70 years of captivity, and I believe he did. That's where the psalm belongs to. Maybe you didn't realize that. It's not David's psalm. It's not a psalm of Asaph or Moses. Not a psalm of Solomon. Not one of the prophets. I believe it belongs to Daniel. I believe it was written in Babylon for the young Jewish boys and girls to learn. It's an alphabetical psalm. All 22 sections represent a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The children were taught to memorize the word of God, the importance of the law of God, and the transgression of that law that brought judgment, and the keeping of that law that brought blessing. They were soon to return again to the land. It was Daniel, through the reading of the book of Jeremiah. That's right, Daniel in Babylon read the book of Jeremiah. And therefore, in reading that book, he remembered the prophecy. After 70 years, they return again to the land. That's why Daniel began to pray. That's why you've got the book of Daniel written. It was written. Now, Daniel didn't return with them. He stayed there. But however, I feel Daniel was an aged man. He was brought into captivity as a child. A little child. He could have been 3 or 4, along with those other Hebrew boys. He, along with those 3 Hebrew men, that they took their stand as young children before the king and refused to eat the king's food and drink the king's wine and refused to bow down to the idol. And opened their windows under the command of death and thrown into the den of lions in order that he might be a martyr for the Lord, and God spurred him. We know the story. It all relates, I believe, to the Babylonish captivity, which we've been dealing here with in the Minor Prophets, and the Psalm 119, I believe, was written by Daniel in Babylon, and all the Hebrew letters, each section of those 22 sections, each section beginning with Aleph and Beth and so on, each beginning with a word under its heading. Whether it's Aleph, each verse begins with Aleph. That's how they remembered and memorized Scripture. And then Beth, they memorized it. And then the word picture, Beth being a picture of the Hebrew letter, Beth is like a house. And we know that Bethlehem, house of God. We know that Bethsheba, house of, or Beersheba. And we know that Bethlehem and other names, and Bethhaven, and all those names given are all house of. That's how we know it. The Hebrew letter is like a house, Beth. And you can see the word picture. And they were learning about the house in the second section of the Psalm 119 under the Hebrew alphabet. And it was a word picture. And all those pictures that pictured the hammer and the nail and the hand and the fence, all speaking of God's provision and God's protection, all built into the Hebrew alphabet. They were taught that in Babylon. When they returned again to the southern and northern kingdoms, they had all that knowledge. They had all that teaching on the law of God. And that's why when Malachi came, his ministry was right and proper, because they were without excuse. And I want to tell you something, men and women. I look at our own nation today. I look at our own land and its departure from God. And the Lord has been good to this land, hasn't he? Think of the revivals that this province and this nation of ours has enjoyed. You think of the revivals in England under the Wesleys and under George Whitefield. And hundreds of thousands of souls were converted in the United Kingdom in England. And you think of Scotland during the time of Knox and during the time of the Covenanters and the preaching of the gospel. And in many ways, they were persecuted by the authorities. They were done to death. I think one of the last Scottish Covenanters was James Renwick. And whenever he was killed, I visited the graveyard in Greyfriars Graveyard in Edinburgh. And there it is, all the history of the Covenanters. And I visited his headstone. The last time we were there, they were doing it up. The Scottish Reformation Society were cleaning it up and they were doing the headstone up. But the whole history of the Scottish Covenanters stood there. Under John Knox's house in the little room where he literally wrote all his sermons, and I stood too in St. Andrew's, where that Roman Catholic bishop had two godly saints of God burnt to death, and the very spot is marked. It's a big blue circle marking the spot where those two Covenanters were burned to death as the Roman Catholic bishop sat on the balcony. You can see the balcony, and he sat there, that fat bishop, sitting there gloating over the burning of Protestants. We forget our history. You know what they do now? They park cars over it. We couldn't see it because they parked a car over it. Scotland has forgotten its history. In fact, Scotland has fallen quicker than any other nation in this United Kingdom into apostasy. The land of Knox, the land of the Scottish Covenanters. And furthermore, you think of the revival there was on the Isle of Lewis in the 1940s under Duncan Campbell. And you think of the revival that was here in this province in 1859. And then again in the 1920s, whenever God established, and we're in our centenary, and we're here now in this centenary, and we've got to remember, when did God send the revival in the 1920s? When was our province and the Northern Ireland came into existence? 1921. That's the very time God raised up W.P. Nicholson, and Nicholson preached the gospel with unusual power. I know he was rude and he was crude, and at the end of his ministry, some people didn't even go to hear him because he was so rude and so crude and so hard on the people. We know that. But God blessed him, and thousands upon thousands of souls. And how did God remember the setting up of the very state of Northern Ireland? He sent a revival in the 1920s. And dare I say, in 1951, God sent another revival. Oh, when was that? In the inception of the Free Presbyterian Church. I believe that was a move of God. In 1951, God separated from Irish Presbyterianism, from Ecumenism, from the Romanist trend of the mainstream Protestant denominations, and from the non-separatist movements. God separated a people unto himself, and he raised up another denomination. And when we feel, and we most likely will, God will raise another up. God will not be without a witness. But I want to tell you something. What about Wales? We don't want to leave Wales out. In 1904, under Roberts and Evans and all of those great revivals in the hills and valleys of Wales, even to this day, Wales is a singing nation. Do you know where it came from? Why do the Welsh sing? It came from the Welsh miners, that God saved thousands of them down in the pits, and they learned to sing. And they sing. You need to hear them singing at the rugby matches in Wales and at the international matches. Even to this day, the fire of revival is still in the hearts of some of the people from 1904. And they're a singing nation. And they sing those great hymns and the Welsh singing. There's nothing like it. The male voice choirs from Wales, you should hear it, singing the old traditional hymns that they sung down in the mines and in the pits as they dug out the coal and came out with the dust in their lungs and their faces black and their smiles on their faces and joy in their hearts because God was working. You think of the gospel preaching for the 100 years in this province and in our United Kingdom. For unbroken centuries, many souls have been converted and they have come to Christ. They've been delivered from the wrath to come. Think of the light of truth that has shone brightly in this little province. Dare I say this? It's the last little bastion of historic, biblical, reformed Protestantism in Europe, if not the world, is this little province. And yet it's a Gentile nation. It is not, I repeat, it is not a mini Israel. It is not, I repeat, in covenant with God. It's a Gentile nation, favored of God. It's a spot on God's created earth that heaven has shined its light upon and favored for centuries. But look at her now. Have a look at it. Look at the state of our land. It has departed from the one true and living God. It has left off the Bible. It's on a collision course with the judgment of God. I want to tell you, it promotes sodomy, immorality. It legislates for gambling and Sabbath desecration. Do you know that there are believers today, Christians, in evangelical churches, and I would suggest to you, in Free Presbyterian churches, and they want us to go easy on sodomy. They're being conditioned. Now that's a fact. And they will leave our churches if we continually expose the sodomite movement. I want to tell you something. One of the biggest issues facing our young people is homosexuality and lesbianism. That's a fact. It will visit this church. Pray God it doesn't visit your home. It is a sin. It is a sin. And God said that he set Sodom and Gomorrah as an example to the world. An example. That's what God thinks of it. But we're more the compassionate than God. And we should let live as they tell us. Christians are saying, well, let them alone. Stop preaching against them. So that's what we do. Say nothing. Just let them practice. No, we can't. If my ministry ends today for saying it, well, I'm happy with that. Sodomy is a sin. We will never let up. And we will never stop exposing it. It brings the judgment, the terrible judgment of God upon a land and a nation. Now, who's saying that today in pulpits? Nobody. That's a fact. They're afraid to touch it. They're afraid of being criminalized. Well, it doesn't matter to me because they can't criminalize a criminal. They can't say, well, you'll blot your copybook. Well, have a look. My record is greater than Elvis Presley. I want to tell you something. We've got to be faithful to God. Call sin, sin. And listen, if we pay the price, so be it. And it's not about keeping people in our churches. It's about being faithful to the Lord. Upholding his word. I would say to you, it'd make you weep what's going on in our land. I'll not get to my other 2 points. Typical. But I will say this, and I feel I've said enough. We need to pray for our country. We need to pray for our fellow Protestant neighbours and Roman Catholic fellow countrymen. We need to pray for others as well in this land, no matter who they are or what their background is or what their sin is. We need to pray for them. We need to be compassionate. Why, we need to call sin out for what it is. We hate the sin, but we don't hate the sinner. We may hate the teachings of a certain movement or religion, but we don't hate the people. We love them in Christ, and we want to see this land saved, delivered. Our motto in the Free Presbyterian Church, maybe you didn't realize it, it's Christ for Ulster, and Ulster for Christ. That's what our motto is. We want to see this land revived, turned back to God. You say that's an impossibility. Well, I tell you, Psalm 119 and the verse 126 reminds me it's time for thee, Lord, to work. Lord, look at our land. If there's ever a time we needed, Lord, for you to come back again, and we know we don't deserve it, what argument could we present to God? What could we say of our land? What could we bring to God now? Right, Lord, here we are. Lord, we're doing this, we're doing that. I want to tell you something. There's nothing. But we can bring his word. Psalm 119, verse 126. It is time for thee to work because they've made void thy law. In our land, Lord, they've made void your law. It's nothing. It's irrelevant. Now it's time, Lord, for you to work. And I'm looking now into heaven to my God by faith. And the eye of faith's beholding the Lord now. And he's looking toward me. His eyes are upon me. And I say, Lord, I bring the only argument, your word. It's time for you now to work. They've made void thy law, Lord. Work, Lord. Do whatever work that is. I'm not telling you, Lord, what to do. I don't know whether it'll be a work of judgment or a work of salvation. But Lord, I pray you'll do thy work. And I pray it'll be a work of mercy and a work of grace and a work of revival and many will be turned to the Lord and saved in this country, and God's people would be revived and get right with God and live a life honoring, pleasing, holy and pure before him, and that young people would commit themselves to the Lord and get right with God, and little children would come to know the Savior and be taught the things of God and grow up and be disciples of the Lord, and we'll have a generation when you and I are about to pass away, we'll have a vibrant church here in Cumber filled with young people and young families that God has brought in, God has saved, and there's not room enough to contain them. So what if we have to rebuild? So what? If God does work, pray he will work in mercy and not in judgment. But I fear there's not much more arguments we have but his own word, that we might say, Lord, it's time. Work, Lord. There's not only a message for our land, there's a message here for the lost. There's a message here for the loved. I may return to this next Lord's Day, I don't know. The message for the lost is this: God's Spirit will not always strive with you. You need to be saved. There's a message for the loved. The Lord is good. He's a stronghold in the day of trouble. He knoweth them that trust in him. In other words, what we're saying here is this: that the Lord understands. And in the day of judgment, whatever he does, whether he works in judgment or mercy, it's well with the saved. It's well with those. That's the message of Nahum. I may not return to it. I may not preach these other 2 points. But that's the message. There's a message for our land. There's a message for the lost. And there's a message for the loved, for those who know him. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. And he knoweth them that trust in him. Father, we pray now you will bless thy word to all of our hearts. Encourage us in the things of God today. And bless thy people. We pray that many will come to know Christ as well through our witness. We pray that others will be turned to the Lord. Father, it is time for thee to work, because, Lord, for they have made void thy law. And we pray for a turning. We think, Lord, of what's going on in our country. We think, Lord, of what's going on in the housing estates. We think of what evil and wicked men are doing to our young people. We think of others who are, Lord, just living off the backs of the people. We think of the fear there is in whole communities because of evil and wicked men in their midst. We think of those who are just living, Lord, in fear and secrecy. They're afraid to speak. They're afraid to show opposition. They're afraid, O God, to voice an opinion. They're afraid, O God, to stand up to evil and wicked men. And Lord, there just seem to be that they're having their way. But who are these people before thee? They're nothing but grasshoppers. They're dust of the earth. Thou art God. Thou art great. And you're good. And we pray you'll turn many from their wicked ways, that you'll save sinners, Lord, that you'll show mercy. And then we pray, Lord, you will spur our land. We pray for our province in its centenary. And no better way to celebrate or even mark the occasion is to see God move again and work in the hearts of this population. It doesn't matter who they are or what religion they are. Lord, if they come repenting and believing, they will be saved. So continue with us today. Do our souls good. Lift up our hearts. Bless us, Lord, and encourage us. Keep our eyes upon the Lord. And we ask it all in Jesus' precious name.